Chapter 6, Section 5, Area of a Circle. This lesson ought to be a pretty quick, simple, skinny one. The formula for area of a circle is area is equal to pi times radius squared, otherwise known as pi times radius squared, where, of course, pi is 3.14, and Ra is the area, and R is a radius. Here we have a circle with a diameter of 22 feet squared. The problem is asking us to find the area. The area is equal to pi times radius squared. Therefore, the first thing we need to do, we need to take and cut this diameter in half to find the radius. So the first question is, what is the radius? Well, the radius is half the diameter, which is going to become 11 feet. So that's the first crucial piece of information we need to solve this problem. From here, we're going to take and use that radius and use pi equals 3.14 to solve the problem. We're using the 3.14 because we're using a whole number or a decimal. If we use a fraction, we're going to use the other representation of pi, which is 22 over 7. So next thing we're going to do, we're going to plug in what we know. We know that pi is 3.14. We know that our radius is 11 feet. Now remember, we're squaring the feet, so just like back when we were using the Pythagorean theorem, we have to put everything the radius is inside the grouping symbols. The radius is not 11, the radius is not feet. The radius is 11 feet, so 11 feet goes in the grouping symbol and the whole thing gets squared. Of course, 11 squared is 11 times 11, otherwise known as 121. And feet times feet is feet squared. From here, all you have to do is multiply these two numbers, 3.14 times 121, 379.94 feet squared, for your final answer, which is circled. That is going to represent your radius. Easy math. Excuse me, not your radius, your area. This one would be a good one for you to pause the recording on while you solve it on your own. In this problem, our pi is still going to be 3.14. This time our radius is 4 feet. They gave us a whole radius, so we're going to put the whole 4 feet in parentheses. 4 feet all squared is 16 feet squared. Multiply that times 3.14, you get 50.24 feet squared. Easy, easy stuff. This one involves a fraction, so let's work it together. The instructions tell you, use pi equals 22 over 7, the fractional version of pi, and we're going to still use the same formula, area equals pi times radius squared, and this time they give us a radius of 3/4 feet. Notice the feet is in the numerator. Your feet always has to stay in the numerator. It cannot be in the denominator, unless it is a different type of problem, which you're not working yet. Next thing we're going to do is take and multiply, can we fill in our missing spots, and then we're going to square everything that is inside the grouping symbol there. We're going to square the 3, we're going to square the 4, and we're going to square the feet. When we do that, 3 times 3 is 9, 4 times 4 is 16, feet times feet is feet squared. Next, we're going to simplify before we multiply. The 22 and the 16 will simplify, becoming an 11 and an 8. I took 2 out of both of those, or divided both by 2, I should say. Numerator times numerator, denominator times denominator. 11 times 9 is 99, 7 times 8 is 56, and then the feet squared came down. Of course, this is an improper fraction. We cannot have an improper fraction for our final answer, so we're going to change that to the mixed number, 1 and 43/56 feet squared. There you go. Circle it. Stick a fork in it. It is done. Now you try that one. Pause the computer. Work it on your own. Once again, we're using the fractional representation of pi because we have a fraction, 2/6 feet, for our radius. Now, if I had a brain in my head before I did anything here, I would simplify 2/6 to be 1/3. Obviously, I do not have a brain because I chose not to do that. Instead, I squared everything inside the grouping symbol. 2 squared is 4, 6 squared is 36, feet squared is feet squared. Now we're going to simplify before we multiply. The 22 and the 36 will simplify, dividing 4. Oh, no, my bad. The 4 and the 36 simplifies. 4 goes into 4 once. 4 goes into 36 9 times. And everything's lowest terms. From there, you get 22 over 63 feet squared. Final answer. That's all she wrote. Your opportunity to expand your mind, page 494, numbers 4 through 24. Odd, notice it says old book. That means there's a worksheet associated with this one. Good luck.
The disturbing answer as Hank Phillippe Ryan investigates.
Rebecca, age 12, sleeps peacefully in her Hanover home. What she doesn't know, right now she's terrifying her parents. We've set off the smoke alarm outside Rebecca's bedroom to see if she'll wake up. And for 2 solid minutes, the alarm shrieks. But Rebecca doesn't move.
What did you just see?
It's disturbing.
And here's what will disturb every parent. If you rely on a smoke detector to wake your sleeping child, that may be a fatal error. More than half of young children who die in home fires are asleep. And one possible reason, as our experiment shows, smoke detectors just didn't wake them up. Lucy Walsh, age 3, sister Hannah, age 5, sister Olivia, age 7, 3-year-old Wyatt Campbell and his big sister Rebecca, all children of Quincy firefighters.
Sometimes put them
with the help of fire safety expert Lieutenant Bob Surveys, we first made sure all the kids understood the basics, the importance of having a fire drill.
So you know what to do in case the real thing does happen.
How a smoke alarm sounds.
Beep, beep, beep.
And what to do when you hear it.
Your first job is to get out, stay out.
We told them we'd be back some night to test their fire safety skills, and that when they hear the alarm, they should instantly get up and get out.
Got it?
A week later, when the kids were all asleep, we set up night vision cameras and set off the smoke alarms. You may think that sound would wake anyone up. Sleep experts say adults, yes. So children, no.
The brain waves are different. Their sleep patterns are different. Their stages of sleep are different.
And look at Wyatt in his crib, not a flinch. Lucy, Olivia, Hannah under the covers, and Rebecca, all sleeping soundly. Experts know in a fire you've got to escape quickly. The deadly smoke and flames spread in an instant, and after 2 minutes, your chances of escape and survival are critically diminished. So we let the smoke alarm ring for 2 full minutes. Wyatt and Rebecca completely oblivious. Their parents completely astonished.
I feel sick. I'm physically ill that she may not have even moved.
At the Walsh kids' home, we even let the alarm ring for a minute longer. Lucy, still no reaction. Hannah, nothing. At one point, Olivia sits up, then pulls the covers over her head to drown out the noise and goes back to sleep. Their parents watched in dismay.
It doesn't work. It doesn't work.
And fire experts know every second of delay may lead to disaster.
Is 3 minutes too long to stay asleep in a fire?
Oh, absolutely. It's way too long.
And as the Campbells watched their slumbering children, they realized when Rebecca babysits for Wyatt, the two children are home alone.
You know, if they were at home without us, I think they would be dead.
Yeah. Something has to be done.
Some researchers say this may be the answer.
Chelsea, wake up.
A smoke alarm that adds a familiar voice to the wake-up warning.
Tyler, this is Dad. Wake up.
This research video we obtained shows the voice alert does seem to work on the test subjects. But would a voice alarm wake our sleeping kids? One company allowed us to try out a product they now have in development. Remember, every child slept through the alarm that beeps. Now watch as a new alarm adds the recorded voice of their parents.
Lucy, wake up!
Little Lucy Walsh, at the sound of her dad's voice, instantly her eyes flutter. 12 seconds later, she's sitting up.
Olivia, here!
Olivia's out of bed in 14 seconds. Hannah's up in 26.
What kind of a difference could that make?
Life or death?
Wyatt, it's Mommy. You have to get out of bed.
3-year-old Wyatt Campbell takes longer, but in less than a minute, he's awake and then crying. Sister Rebecca, hearing her mother's voice, is awake in 6 seconds.
Rebecca, wake up! It's Mom. It's a fire drill.
She fights to get back to sleep, but she just can't ignore that voice.
Rebecca, wake up! It's Mom.
In 30 seconds, she's out of bed and into her father's arms.
Wake up. Come on.
Experts emphasize smoke detectors are essential in every home. But for these parents at least, our experiment is a wake-up call to their limitations.
What does that mean to you?
The life of my children. I mean, what's more important than that?
Parents can easily test in home fire drills to see if their children will wake up at the sound of the smoke detector. If they don't, that's a clear signal to adjust the family escape plans. Those voice alarms should be on the market in the coming months. Check our website for more information. In the newsroom, I'm Hank Phillippi Ryan.
Thank you.